A man is eating meat, and the boy standing behind the man is hungry. The boy is gatekeeping, and he looks at the man and think, "Don't gobble up that meat so brazenly." As he was in his thoughts, someone came and asked him, "Hey, what are you doing just standing there?" The people came, and one of them pointed at the boy and questioned him that is he trying to tarnish the name of the Blelek household, one of the five great families. The boy looked down and said that he is sorry to Raphael-sama. Raphael looked at him disgustingly and said he can't believe he have to waste a salary on scum like him and tossed some coins toward the boy. The boy gets angry, but he can't do anything because he is poor. The coins were on the ground, and Raphael asked him, "What is the matter? Are you not going to pick it up?" He added that the boy should be grateful for this salary. The boy bends down to pick up the coins, and Raphael adds that his incompetent skills in this field of work are taking the place of an honorable holy knight. He said, "You know what I mean." Raphael bullied the boy, saying, "Normally, there isn't a salary for people like him." Raphael asked him why don't pick the money up more eagerly and added that his mistake is their responsibility. If this goes on, he will end up with a fate worse than beheading. As the boy picks up the money, his stomach growls loudly because of hunger. Raphael again started bullying him, saying, "What the hell are those noises?" Raphael kicked the boy in the stomach and said that he is acting as though they don't feed him. He asked if that is what he is trying to imply. The boy fell to the ground and winced in pain. Raphael's friend pointed at the boy and asked, "What's that? He looks like a maggot." Raphael said, "Come on, get up quicker. Otherwise, I will be accused of negligence and poor gatekeeping by the other holy knights." Raphael placed his foot on the boy's head and crushed it, and said to him to get the fuck up at once. Another voice came from behind as someone says, "Raphael, stop it." She walked closer to them and added, "He will die. This is unsuitable behavior for a holy knight." Raphael removed his foot from the boy's head, looked at the person, and says, "So, Roxy Hart is on today's shift." Roxy Hart goes to the boy, and Raphael and his friends start leaving. Before leaving, Raphael said that, at best, he should be diligent while standing on guard. Raphael looked at the boy and smirked. Roxy Hart addressed the boy by his name Fate and asked him if he is all right. Fate looked at her and thought that his name was like that. He can't believe she remembered it. Fate says he is fine and thanked her for helping him. Roxy Hart tells him to don't thank her. She extended her hand for Fate to support him to get up and added that they are comrade gatekeepers after all. She told him to take turns and added that if they ever do anything like that to him again, she will. Fate didn't let her complete the sentence as he said he is all right and started leaving, saying, "Well, I will be off." Fate runs from there as he thinks of Roxy. He thinks he doesn't want her to get involved with those guys because of him. He wants her to follow her own path without being held back, and that would also be for the sake of the kingdom. Fate walks into the town, and his stomach growls again. He thought hard bread and thin soup won't do. They hardly do anything to fill his stomach. He further thought that in this world, everyone is born with a skill. It's a blessing that God has gifted them, but there are also those in this world who are not blessed by God. Fate's skill is gluttony. It is simply a skill that makes one excessively hungry. He thinks that he is an unnecessary person in this world. On the other hand, some people are holy knights in their own twisted way. They are people you would be unable to beat in a fight. Fate took after his ancestor, and he thinks that those guys will beat him to death, which reminds him of Raphael and his comrades. Fate hopes that they aren't harassing Roxy-sama. Fate walks by the buildings, and suddenly Roxy is in front of him, gatekeeping. He looked at her and felt relieved, but something else caught his attention. There were intruders who were trying to climb the building. Fate realized that for Roxy-sama, that is a blind spot, so he hurried up to let her know. He runs toward her and called her. Roxy-sama also saw him coming and asked Fate did he not return home. Fate explained to Roxy that they have a big problem. There were bandits climbing the east wall over there. Roxy was surprised and asked him if that is true. Fate said yes, there is no doubt about it. Roxy took a breath and said calmly that she got it. She hands over the polearm to Fate and says that she will make her way there, and asked him that while she is gone, could he take over as gatekeeper for her? Fate replied of course, and she gets ready to leave with her sword. Fate called her and said best of luck. She smiled at him and told him to leave it to her, and she added that she is confident in her ability to stop them. And with that Roxy left, and Fate worriedly looked at her. As Roxy heads towards the east wall, she encounters a group of intruders there and fought with them. After some time, Fate realized that it's become quiet and thought, is it over? Roxy-sama really is amazing. He was in his thought when one of the intruders came toward Fate. His one hand was bleeding, and Fate thought it was Roxy-sama but got surprised. The intruder called him Small Fry and told him to get out of his way. Fate was surprised as he thought someone made it past, and if Fate let him pass here, the blame will fall on Roxy-sama. So held the polearm tightly, and thought there is no way he can let him pass. So Fate attacked him with the polearm. He defeated the intruder and said, "I did it." Suddenly, Fate felt something. His gluttony skill activated. Stamina plus 150, will plus 100, strength plus 150, agility plus 30, everything increased in him. He got surprised and thought that this feeling, it is like his stomach is filling up. His every stat was up, and appraisal and mind reading were added. Roxy Hart came and saw him. She called his name and asked him if he is alright and if he is hurt. Roxy grabbed Fate's shoulder worriedly and told him that she mistakenly let one guy slip through. He told him he is pale and she is worried. Fate gets nervous, so Roxy asked him if something is wrong. He replied, "No, it is nothing." He tells her that he is really fine, and added that he didn't even get hurt. Roxy says, "I see," and signs. What a relief. Thank goodness. Roxy removed her hand from him, and he thought, "What was that just now?" Fate called her and told her to pretend as though she took care of all of them. She said that is not fair and asked him, "Didn't he also take care of one of them?" He replied that was also thanks to her. He added that if Raphael Sama hears about this, it will be troublesome. She agreed to him and said, "Okay, understood. They will report it the way Fate suggested." Fate thanked her again, saying, "Thank you very much." Roxy said that she is the one who should thank him. If he hadn't warned her about them, she did have damaged the name of the Hart family. She added to let her thank him properly. Fate gets nervous and said, "No need. Having a holy night, thank him, would be." Roxy made a face, and Fate thought, "So even she can make a face like that." Roxy thought for a few seconds looking for a way to thank him, and then she said, "Got it." She smiled at Fate and said, "Why don't he come and work for the Hart family?" She added that she is sure her father will take him in if she tells him about this. Fate got surprised and said, "No way." He added that his skill is useless and there is an issue with the Blelick family. Roxy told him that he doesn't need to worry about the Blelick family and questioned him does he was intent on working for the Blelick his entire life. When Fate thought about it, he realized that would not be good. Fate then bowed to her and said that then he looked forward to working with her. She replied good and added that it is already late, so he should go home today, and told him to come to the Hart household the day after tomorrow at noon. She added that she will be waiting for him. Fate again bowed to her happily and said thank you very much to her. He can't believe how happy he is feeling. In the dark night, Fate is standing on dead bodies, holding a sword in his hands. A skull masks on his face, but suddenly he opened his eyes and woke up. Fate had a nightmare. He felt like he just had a weird dream, and then he thought that what happened yesterday wasn't a dream. Right? He remembered everything, from Raphael bullying him to him killing the intruder. On that note, he wondered about the voice he heard yesterday. He thought what it said was appraisal and mind reading. As he was thinking about it, a chart appeared in front of him. He realized that he can actually see his status now. Amazing. He saw his stats and got surprised because all of his stats have increased. He said what in the world with a shocked expression and added that his stats has increased to 3 digits, even though all his stats should be 1. He thought that appraisal and mind reading really have been added to his skills. So the reason why he heard that voice back when Roxy touched him last night was because of this skill. He thought, is this the effect of gluttony? Stealing the lives of those he kills and turning them into your own power. Fate felt a different sensation and thought that he had never felt this sensation before. He felt fulfilled. Fate grinned as he thought he now know that is what it was. And now that he knows, he said there is only one thing left to do. Fate leaves his house and goes to Safe Hart Business District. People are walking here and there doing their work. Fate looked at the coins he had in his palm and thought all he have are these 2 silver coins. If he wants to buy a weapon, it can only be from somewhere around here. He doesn't even think that people will let him step foot into the high-class stores. As he was walking by the stores, a shop owner called him, saying, "Oniason, might you be looking for a weapon?" Fate goes to the old shop owner and told him that he saw right through him. The old man stated that he was walking around while ogling the weapons. So, of course, he did know. The old man asked Fate, "So what does he think? Want to take a look?" As he pointed at the weapons in his store, Fate thought that he did be able to afford something from a place like this. So he said okay to the old man. The old man asked Fate for his budget to buy weapons. Fate hesitantly showed the 2 silver coins to the old man. The old man made a disgusted face and said to Fate that he is piss poor after all and added he shouldn't have been so kind. The old man showed Fate some weapons and told him that the trash weapons there are the only ones he could afford. He laughed at Fate and said they suit him perfectly. Fate got disappointed and thought it will probably be the same no matter where he will go, so he might as well choose one from here. So he walked towards the trash weapons and reached out for one. As he reached for the weapon, he saw the stats of the weapons immediately. He thought that they really are nothing but scrap. He wishes there was something at least a little usable. Fate reached for a black sword, and as he touched it, a voice came from the sword, and it said, "By me." Fate got surprised as he stepped back. The sword lightens up. He thought, how did this sword just talk? Fate got surprised and thought, just now, the sword just talk. The old man said to him if he isn't planning to buy anything, then get lost already. Fate heard the old man and looked at him. He wondered if was he the only one who heard it. Fate again approached the sword hesitantly and held it in his hand. Again a voice came from the sword saying, interesting, you aren't running away. Fate thought he knew it. It is talking to him through the mind reading skill. He thought, is this sword cursed or something? It doesn't really seem that unusual, though. He checks the stats of the sword, but to his surprise, the only thing he saw was its name and form. He can't see anything apart from its name and form. Fate thought that the way this sword is treated is just like him. The sword asked Fate, what will it be? Will he buy it? Fate looked at the other swords and thought that this one is also the only one that looks usable. So he made up his mind and said, yeah, I will take you. He added that he doesn't have any money anyway, and he feels like they resemble each other. The sword said, very well. This must be some kind of destiny, no, maybe fate. The sword added that he will accompany him for the rest of his days. The sword asked Fate, what is his name? And he replied, saying his name is Fate. Fate Graphite. He asked the sword what should he call him. The sword said, very well, and told him that he is Greed. Greed added that he should feel honored to be able to wield him. The old man interrupted their conversation as he shouted at Fate, saying, how long is he going to browse for, broke bastard. Fate gets annoyed by his behavior and tossed the coins on his table. The old man didn't get to say anything as a new customer came to his store. He said to him, ah, welcome. Fate thought that he will never come to this store again. He left and roamed in the market with his sword and thought, he will go hunt goblins in the nearby field. Greed said, just right for a newbie for him. But don't get ahead of yourself just because he has got a great weapon like him now. Goblins can swarm, after all. Fate said he know and said, listen up. The thing about goblin is and thought about the old geezer at a bar once told him. Fate reached the capital's south gate and thought, there is a lot of warriors here. Does everyone gather around here before heading out to hunt monsters? Fate said he can make an impromptu party here. Sounds nice having comrades. Greed said to Fate that he has him, doesn't he? Fate replied, that's not what he meant. Suddenly someone called Fate, saying, you over there. He asked Fate if he is a warrior too, right? And added, if he did like, then they can form a party because the guy he usually hunts with couldn't make it today. Fate got excited and said he mean it. The other guy said yeah and asked him what is his level. Fate said proudly that it's 1. And suddenly the other guy was nowhere to be found. Greed told Fate that he did better give up on finding companions. Greed meant who would want to team up and fight monsters with a level 1. Fate signed and said that here he was getting excited after buying a sword. Greed told him that is just how it is and added that he shouldn't show his gluttony to other people. Fate got surprised and said, wait, how does he know about gluttony? Greed replied, that is because you and I are the same. Greed added that he will probably understand soon whether he wants to or not. Fate thought he is right. Fate also doesn't think it is wise to let other people know about a skill like that. If they find out about his skill, there is a chance he may get killed. Fate smirked and added, but because he has this power, he can become so strong that nobody could even lay a hand on him. And then Fate decided and said, alright, first up is hunting goblins. Fate arrived south of the capital at the so-called Goblin Field. Goblins have made this their home. They attack and pillage any carriages passing through the field. Fate was looking for them when he saw a goblin sleeping, and Fate thought, this is it. Fate was hiding in the bush as he thought, it doesn't look like any other enemies are around, and it's even sleeping. Fate saw the stats of the goblin, and it said this goblin is a goblin fighter. Fate thought that judging from the name, there are other types as well, and his stats are much lower than his. Fate noticed his skill is strength up. He wondered, since there is a small, a big might also exists. He realized that he is in wide open, and he attacked him. The goblin woke up, and Fate's gluttony was also activated. Fate killed the goblin, and strength up was added to his skills. Fate checked his stats and said okay. He happily thought they are increasing. He is getting stronger. Greed then called him and told him to don't get so excited over a mere goblin's skill. The day will be over before he knows it if he does. Fate said, oh, come on. It's his first time defeating a monster, after all. He added that he doesn't think it's the same for other warriors, but he has only ever been able to run away from monsters until now. Greed replied, okay, okay. Fate goes nearer to the goblin and said, let's see. Fate cuts the ear of the goblin and puts it in his bag and thought that he remembers that if you take the ear, you can get money for it from a converter, right? Only 10 copper per goblin, though. He hoped he can earn more than he did as a guard. After collecting it, he excitingly said, alright, on to the next one. Fate looked for another goblin and came across one. Fate observed him and thought, this one is with a shield. Gotta be a new type. He checked the goblin's stats and thought, so it's a goblin guard. That shield looked troublesome to Fate. He further thought that they covered each other's weak points and guessed that they specialized in attacking in groups of two. One is with a shield and the other without it. Fate guessed that he should start off with the offense, the goblin fighter, and also realized that he did be a pain if he suddenly get blocked by that shield. He thought that he don't have much fighting experience, so he did like to be sure that he killed both of them. And in that case, he gripped his sword with both hands as the goblins were standing with full attention. Fate looked for his chance and attacked them. Fate attacked the goblins. Goblin with the shield came forward, and Fate realized that it's going to block him, but something unexpected happened. Fate's sword broke the shield in two pieces, and the goblin was also dead. Fate's gluttony was again activated, and stamina up was added to his skills. Fate was shocked as he realized he had cut through it and looked at his sword. The other goblin attacked him, and Fate cut his arm and sword. Fate said he didn't get the fighter's skill and he checked his status. Everything was again increased. His stamina is 221, strength is 251, magic is 131, will is 131, and agility is 201. Skill, gluttony, appraisal, mind reading, strength up, and stamina up. He understood that he can only have one of each skill. He thought that if he want a new skill then he should hunt other monsters. Fate asked Greed why he was treated so badly when he is this amazing. Fate cuts both goblins' ears, and Greed replied that it's simple, because he chooses his wielder. Fate said to him that means he recognized him as his wielder. Greed told him to shut his trap. Fate thought that it's foul mouth, but if it was him it recognized, then he need to live up to its expectations. After a while of hunting, Fate had a bag full of goblin ears. He said, "Oh my, what a haul." He doesn't know why they did, but he was lucky all the goblins just appeared before him like that. And then he wondered how his status looked now. He checked his stats and said, "Holy moly," in a surprised way. He added, "Is this for real? No way." Stamina, strength, and agility are all over 1,000. But he wondered why he still didn't level up. He thought that he should have gotten quite a lot of spheres. Greed told him it's because he holds one of the sacrilegious skills that he cannot receive the sphere's blessings. Fate got shocked and wondered if he is committing sacrilege. Greed explained to Fate that gluttony is the act of stealing the stats and skills of others when he kills them, which means that he rejects the divine concept of levels. Greed added that people like him will receive no blessing from the gods. His stats all being one at the start was also proof of that. Greed asked Fate if he knew about it. Fate got shocked after hearing what Greed said. Greed was about to say something else too, as he added also, but ended it with "it's nothing." Fate got inquisitive as he said, "Oh, come on," and told Greed that he is curious now. Greed said that it's still light out, so they better get back to the capital. Fate lifted his sword and said, "Now listen here you." He couldn't complete his sentence as his stomach growled. He is hungry now. He said to Greed that, well, he is right, and told him that he is hungry and thinks they did enough for today. Fate thought that next time he will go to another forest and will try to fight a hobgoblin, and with that, he started leaving for his home. Fate entered the capital with his bag full of goblin ears. People everywhere were chit-chatting, buying, and selling things. Fate walked past them and stepped into a store to convert his goblin ears to coins. When he entered the store, he saw two men fighting over something. He thought he did already hear the rumors, but the guild really is as rough as they say. Both of them pushed past Fate, and he stumbled a little. One said to Fate, "Out of the way, small fry." Fate nervously said sorry to him, and the lady from the counter called the next person, "Please." Fate nervously thought, "Thank goodness," as he approached the counter. He said to the lady that he did like to exchange these as showed his bag of ears. The lady said, "Let me take a look," and took a look at his bag. She gets surprised by the number of ears and said, "Oh my, that sure is a lot of goblin ears." She asked Fate, "Did he hunt with a large party?" The lady asked that he must have drawn a lot of aggro hunting this many, huh? Fate replied, "Aggro." The lady explained to him that if he kill many of the same species in one day, monsters of that species will bear a grudge and start targeting him. So that is why people usually only kill 10 in one day at most. Fate didn't know about this fact, so he nervously said, "Is that so?" and told her that he is new, so he didn't know. He thought that is why so many monsters came at him while he was fighting. The lady asked him, saying he is surely only in rags because he fought so much, right? She complimented her by adding, "A good job." Greed said, "That's just what he wears, ha." And Fate told him to shut up. The lady got surprised by his sudden change in tone and comment. Fate waved his hands nervously towards the lady and said he just thought those guys fighting were being too noisy. The lady smiled and said then she will prepare his reward and told him to wait just a moment. While he was waiting, his stomach growled again, and he thought about what he should have for dinner. He hoped that he can eat something filling. As he was thinking about his dinner, Greed called him. Greed said, "Hey, it feels gross being so dirty." He told Fate that he did better clean him up before dinner, and added that Fate really need to give him proper maintenance after fighting. It's just as important to him as food is to Fate. While they talked, Fate took his reward and left the store thinking he didn't even perform maintenance on Greed once after buying it. Fate said okay, okay, and looked for a blacksmith nearby. After a while, Fate left the blacksmith store and said thank you very much. He held his earned money and thought that he ended up earning more money than what he had saved up these past 5 years in just half a day. And he still has more left after paying the blacksmith. He questioned how worthless were his last 5 years and thought about Raphael and his comrades. But then he cheered himself up by thinking to not think about it. He has already said goodbye to that kind of life. He has got to face the future. Greed told him that it's good that he is thinking ahead and all, but he will be in trouble if he at least doesn't learn to maintain Greed himself. Fate said that, well, he guessed Greed is right and told Greed that he didn't even have any scratches, and paying copper every day sounds awful. He thought that if he ever have to travel anywhere, he won't even be able to go to a blacksmith. And he had been fighting alongside this guy. So Fate said that he got it. After dinner, he will go buy some tools for maintenance. Greed said to Fate that it means he finally understood how great he is, and he better be as careful as if he were polishing gemstones. Fate asked Greed he really is a proud weapon, and Greed replied, of course, he is Greed after all. Fate goes for his dinner as he thinks it will be okay to have a bit of a luxurious meal today. He started to decide what he should have, and he decides it's going to be meat, delicious meat. He stood in front of a shop and thought this place smelled rich in grilled meat. Fate said, all right, let's eat here. When he was about to enter the shop, a man came and walked towards him and pushed him aside. Fate hit the floor and saw a little girl with that man. The girl was in a bad condition, and the man was pulling her by her hand. The man questioned Fate angrily, where the hell is he looking, stupid bastard. Fate also replied to him in his tone, what did he call him? The man takes the little girl's hand and told her to stand up already. Fate called him and tried to stop him saying hey, and he grabbed the shoulder of the girl. When he grabbed her shoulder, Fate heard a voice saying save me. He got surprised by this sudden voice as the man dragged the girl with him, and Fate thought, what was that just now? Fate could not understand at all why a girl he never knew yet would ask him to help. That man was not her father. Is she being abducted? He wondered. Fate tried to use his ability to check the statistics of the man who was dragging the crying girl, and was shocked to see that there were no skills listed on the tab. Greed explained to Fate that it must be a hiding skill that lets a person hide the skill that the owner has, making it impossible for people to see his or her skills, but it can be figured out that the man is a warrior in accordance to his stats. Even though the man had lower stats than Fate, he had the eyes of a murderer, representing that he would not think twice before swinging his blade at a human being. Fate decided to go and save the girl and let the food wait for some time. Greed advised him to never try to show mercy to a man who doesn't hesitate before killing people, as it may harm him later. Fate followed the girl and the kidnapper to a warehouse. Fate peeks from the broken window just to see the girl chained by the pillar. He slapped the girl for no reason at all, as he mentioned how he loves kidnapping kids, as they become obedient as soon as they are threatened a bit. He pitied the little girl for having a useless ability and being abandoned by her parents. The glimpse of the little girl lying on the ground made Fate remember his time when he was also bullied for having a useless ability and how people treated him in the worst way possible. The kidnapper further told the girl that she would become a plaything to a holy knight, and that the last girl he kidnapped couldn't live much and died in just a week as he kicked her belly, making her fly meters away. Such a scene aggravated Fate down to his wits' Greed and warned him not to let his emotions take control of him. Fate calmed him down and reached out to the girl after the man left through the door. Fate used his sword's ability to cut through the chain as the girl cheered, thinking that she was free now and Fate would save him from the kidnappers. Suddenly, all her expressions changed to fear as Fate looked back to see the kidnapper looking at him. Fate looks back to see what made the girl look so terrified, even though he saved her. The big bruiser who kidnapped the girl was looking right toward him. He told Fate that he was looking out for some entertainment as he pointed his sword at him. It didn't take much time for Fate to realize that he had walked right into a trap. Fate and Greed knew that this was a difficult situation, as it is hard to fight while protecting a girl. Greed commanded Fate to take a step back, and he did so. The kidnapper was confident in his abilities, making him a bit careless. Fate lured him into a cozy place and swung at him directly while the kidnapper's guard was down, cutting right through him. The kidnapper told Fate in his breaking voice that Hud Blylock was the one behind all this kidnapping. The same family Fate was working for him. Fate promised him that he would put the Blylock family, the evildoers, in their place. Fate absorbed the kidnapper's skills and received a sharp-edged skill that lets you hit twice when countering. Afterward, both Fate and the little girl had their fill in the beautiful and fancy restaurant and then dropped the girl back in the same orphanage which was close to his slum. All the nuns finally calmed down after being worried by the absence of the little girl. The little girl presented her gratitude to Fate with tears in her eyes and Fate bid farewell to her. He realized, looking at the little girl's face, that he still had a long way to go and it would be a rough and hard route he had to follow. Suddenly, the thought of visiting Roxy's family castle strikes his mind. The nervousness is a self-explanation for various reasons. That Roxy has always been polite to him even though she is a holy knight. Tomorrow Fate needs to go to the mansion of five great families. On the other hand, Greed was all calm and cool. He mentioned that he was a weapon. Indeed, why would he get agitated for such petty reasons? The next only thought that came to Fate's mind was only what he would wear to the mansion tomorrow, now that it was midnight. None of the stores are open and he didn't have a choice but to walk down the alley back to his home for the time being. Fate has come a long way from where he was then to now, from a small disrespected gatekeeper to such a man who can protect himself and has a nice weapon and gear for himself. He is not dependent on the coins thrown at him by the Blelick family and is a separate identity by himself. Fate is now ready in his nice, shiny outfit and his leather bag and boots to go to Mrs. Roxy's mansion. The guard lets him in as a guest and shows Fate where Roxy is, while Fate praises the beauty and peace of the surroundings. After walking through the beautiful bushes and greenery, he comes across Roxy Sama herself in her beautiful dress, unlike the armor she wore at other times. Fate was left speechless and mesmerized by her beauty, making Roxy blush at his sudden compliment. Roxy leads the way to her father's grave. She tells her father's grave that she will be hiring Fate as she puts on a bouquet while paying respect to him. Roxy's father passed away 5 days ago in Gallia. Gallia is the capital of the southern continent ruled by extremely strong monsters, unlike the monsters here. This happened just before the intruders incident occurred. Fate wonders how she was hiding the grief of her father's death while she motivated him then. She further mentions that even though these monsters were really strong, they were not the reason for her father's death. It was due to the disaster in Gallia. The Sky Dragon is considered a natural disaster due to its unimaginable strength, just like an earthquake or flood. Avoiding such a disaster is inevitable. The Sky Dragon suddenly came and annihilated Roxy's father and the massive army he was leading. Nobody could even imagine that the Sky Dragon would fly all across to the outer edges of the capital from his nest, which was far away from the place in the heart of the continent. Which was unexpected, as such a case was never recorded in decades, not even a single instance. Roxy just got free this afternoon after the funeral, claiming his inheritance and taking the respectful steps which were needed as she bitterly smiled in pain and grief over the absence of her father. Fate was able to easily observe the young girl grieving in front of him. Fate could hear his inner voice telling him to get stronger so that he doesn't have to let Roxy down ever again. As Roxy announced that she would be the one to raise the status of the house in place of her father and asked Fate to help her out, the same. In reply to this, Fate wore in front of her father's grave that he would help her as they looked at each other in pure determination and focus. Fate's inner voice still kept telling him that this was not enough. He was hungry and he needed more and more. The bright sunlight filtered from the windows as Fate woke up with a smile on his face looking out to a beautiful new day. Fate excitedly started his day greeting the gardener as he spent his day enjoying his gardening work in the mansion with the head gardener. Afterward, Fate couldn't stop smiling as he saw meat on his plate during dinner with everyone around him. Something was a bit different even though Fate was eating his fill. Something made him feel that his hunger is not being quenched. He could feel a worse hunger in himself which was different from every other time yet. Roxy called Fate out of his dream world he was in while deep thinking. Roxy came close to Fate to check on Fate if he was fine as he looked a bit pale and overworked to her. Fate tried to calm her down and tell her that he is fine. Something happened to Fate the moment he said that he was getting sucked in a whirlpool as he fainted right in front of Roxy on the dinner table. Fate woke up back on his bed. He wondered what is happening to him. He fell on the small note from Roxy asking him to take a day off. Fate regretted again being a burden to Roxy and sleeping for the whole day. He asked Greed about the situation and why this is happening to him as he has never felt such a hunger yet. Greed knew about this. He explained to Fate that the die has been cast and it was too late now. The more souls Fate's skill eats, the stronger it will get, and now that his skill has tasted a soul, there is no way back, and he must keep feeding him more and more souls to his skill, hence this skill is called starvation mode. Fate could see his red burning eyes in the mirror representing his hunger and activation of his skill, and it will keep getting worse until he dies or end up attacking everyone around him. He can always live his life as a servant with Roxy, but this is something that will always be there deep inside him and he must keep fighting in a hidden way. The thought of Fate attacking his close ones or Roxy herself scared his wits due to his starvation of the skill. He instantly grabbed his gear, and Warit took his weapon, and left the mansion in a hurry out to somewhere. Fate runs out of the mansion panting as all he feels is pain even though he is not tired, but all he feels is his hunger when suddenly his nose senses some delicious smell around him. Fate looks forward just to find two guards looking at him. The guards inquire if he is fine, but they get scared as they look into Fate's deep red eyes. Fate controls himself and walks past the guard to avoid any more suspicion. Greed explained to Fate that his skill forces him to consider anyone weaker than him as prey without thinking about who he or she is or what post they may have, and his skill tells this to him by sensing a smell from the weaker ones. Fate wondered if he has fallen into danger as the guards must have seen him and his weird behavior, also his red eyes, but Greed disagreed and explained that as everyone is not known about his skill gluttony and how dangerous it can be, the guards will just think that he is just another scary man or something they have imagined instead of being suspicious until and unless they see Fate's red scary eyes again. Another beautiful smell entered Fate's nose as he walk on the road. He suddenly observes three people in their black suspicious robes, just to find out they are his three old masters from Blelic family, the ones who threw coins at him and used to bully him when he worked as the gatekeeper in the Holy Castle. Fate wonders why would they sneak around looking like that, as they are holy knights. They must be out to do some bad work as they entered a huge wooden gate. Even though he wanted to observe them more and follow them, his hunger didn't allow him to do that. He started running again forward as his eyes fell on a hunter's group getting ready for a good night of hunting, planning to aim for the sleeping monsters. One of the hunters taunted Fate about being a loner. They laughed him away for being alone as Fate tried his best to control himself. Fate ran out to the goblins' field and went all berserk. He started brutally beheading all the goblins that came in his way, but his craving didn't stop at all. His hunger increased more and more with every goblin he killed. Will he be able to stop himself? Fate hunted quite a lot, but the intensity of gluttony had calmed down only a little. Moreover, his eyes were still red and creepy. He wondered how many more it needed before this starvation stopped. Greed analyzes the situation and concludes that it doesn't seem like goblins would be enough. So now Fate had to go to some other place to continue his thirsty hunt. He did feel stronger than usual, but that was because of starvation. Greed tells him that his red eyes increase his strength, which he could use to help gluttony eat till it's full. Since goblins didn't satisfy his hunger, Fate had to move towards hobgoblins. It is said that they are goblins that began living in this forest after evolving. Here, there are three types of hobgoblins: fighters, guards, and archers. Fate could easily deal with the fighters and guards, but he hesitated when it came to fighting with the archers. The arrowheads were coated with the waste of the hobgoblins, and one would get infected if they got hit with them. People tend to call them poop archers. Fate was glad that his servant Senpai taught him something useful, and he would never have thought that he would get to apply his knowledge so soon. Fate then spots some hobgoblins, and he checks their appraisal. The one he spotted was a hobgoblin fighter, and as for his skills, it had two-handed swordsmanship. Another one was a guard, and it has stamina up medium skill. Now that he was going to attack them, he apologizes first. The very next moment, Fate attacks the hobgoblin, and it yells in pain. He wonders if this monster was calling for reinforcements, but Fate wouldn't let that happen. Gluttony activates, and he gains those skills. Well, this felt much more filling than goblins. Okay, Fate then continues his hunt, and he ultimately hunts 45 hobgoblins. Lo, Fate was finally satisfied, and he was no longer hungry. Greed understands that his starvation has stopped. Yes, finally. So Fate decided to take a short rest, as he was tired from all this hunting activity. Greed suggests that he should better climb a tree, as there might be some hobgoblins still wandering around at night. Moreover, Fate no longer has a boost from starvation. Well, Greed was absolutely right, and so Fate hopped on the tree. He then realizes that he sure has to beat a lot of monsters to satisfy starvation. Greed agrees with him, as Fate should know well enough by now that gluttony is not something that is easily satisfied. And if Fate didn't want to end up attacking someone, he should be more regular in hunting down monsters. Fate was certain that he never wanted to feel that hungry again. After resting for a while, it was about time to go back. That's when Fate hears some creepy sound, and something's actually there right down there. The monster was huge, and there was something in his hand. Fate wondered whether it was a person. Damn, it definitely has to be one of those guys that he met earlier. They acted smart and then came here and got killed. Fate then checks this monster's appraisal, and damn, it's the Goblin King. This creature was similar to the boss of this forest. An encounter like this should be incredibly rare, but it's supposed to lead to certain death if one does run into it. Lo, the best part was that its skill is regeneration, and now Fate would like to have this skill. He analyzes the situation, and it doesn't seem impossible to hunt down the Goblin King. Okay, so Fate makes up his mind and starts observing the Goblin King. Gross, that monster was eating a human. Greed knew that Fate was scared, even if it was a normal thing for monsters. Greed also tells Fate that humans are quite the treat for monsters, especially human children. Yes, yes, Fate understands that now, but Greed needs to stop it. It was really a big shock to actually witness this live scenario. Anyway, Fate had a plan, and Greed suggests taking it slow. Fate slowly approaches the King Goblin and strikes an attack. Finally, he did it, but he couldn't let his guard down as it wasn't dead yet. The Goblin King tries to harm Fate, but he quickly goes back after listening to Greed. One more attack, and damn, this was close. Greed knew that Fate was not out of danger yet, as the Goblin King was coming for him. The monster growls even louder, and this is bad. The Goblin King constantly attacks its opponent as if its life depended on it. Well, it did. Fate was extremely scared, as the Goblin King was so strong. And if that club hits him, he'll definitely die. No, actually, Greed knew that a club like that one was nothing, and Fate trusted him. So now it was time for a counterattack. Fate puts himself together and strikes an attack directly at the monster. He chops off its hands, and the Goblin King seems to be in terrible pain. It was about time for the last attack, and dang, the Goblin King is dead. Gluttony activates, and the regeneration skill is added. Fate somehow managed to beat it at last. Greed appraises Fate, and after calculating, he concludes that these stats should be enough to unlock his first rank. Greed elucidates by saying that he could take on more and more forms by receiving stats from his wielder. Fate asks him how many stat points he needs, and Greed tells him that he needs everything that Fate has gained since they met. Well, he's Greed and it is just in his nature to take everything. Nevertheless, if Fate doesn't unlock the first rank, he will lose the right to wield Greed. So now Fate has two options, either to grow stronger on his own or to grow stronger alongside Greed. Even though Greed was greedy for power, there was no need for Fate to think about it. Greed is his one and only partner, and Greed was certain that Fate wouldn't regret this choice. They decide to stick together, and Fate transfers his stat points to him. Boom. Greed gets a new, beautiful form. It's the magic bow form, and Greed could now help Fate in two aspects. This was all for the first rank, so that meant that Greed also has a second and third rank, which will need quite a lot of stats. Next up, Greed notices some monsters behind Fate. They were aiming at him, the archers. The goblins were continuously aiming at Fate, and Greed helped him dodge the arrows with poop. The most terrifying thing was that Fate couldn't make out where they were coming from. Greed advises trying to aim at them, as with this form, Fate only needs to roughly know where they are to hit them. Greed also explains the process of the formation of arrows that will take place with mana. Alright then, Fate aims in a particular direction, and it does hit a poop archers. After winding up this matter, Fate hurried to go home before the sun rose. Greed reminds Fate about taking away the Goblin King's ear. Fate tells him that this would make him stand out way too much, after all, he was only at level 1. Hang on, Fate definitely has some other plans, and he then takes away the Goblin King's ear. The next day, someone knocks on the door and wakes Fate. He opens the door to find out that it's none other than Roxy-sama, and she looks as fresh as a flower. She was holding a basket full of grapes and asked Fate if he was feeling well. Oh boy, he just got flushed by looking at Roxy-sama. She also notices that he is spacing out and wonders if he is alright. Fate assures her that he is fine. Roxy-sama was here to check on him, and she also brought him some food. These grapes are harvested from the Heart Territory, which is a beautiful place surrounded by green. Roxy-sama plucks out a grape from the bunch, and she tries to feed it to Fate. He really feels so shy, but she behaves in a casual way. But before she could feed it to him, the senior maid approached her and reminded her that it was about time to leave. She bids goodbye to Fate, and while going, she informs him about her plans to return to her territory pretty soon, and she asks him to come along. This guy is still in shock. He notices how busy Roxy-sama is, and he feels that somewhere or other he keeps hindering her work schedule. Only if he could become more important, but that was not possible. Well, now that he has a day off, Fate decides to go and drink for the first time in a while. After a while, he arrives at the merchant district, but it is still quite early, so he decides to browse some stalls first. He uses his appraisal skill to learn the value of various goods. Fate then comes across a skull mask, which prevents the wearer from being recognized. He quickly purchases it, and Greed approves of it too. This mask would help him hide his identity when he hunts monsters at night. Fate suddenly stops dead when he hears people talking about how the corpses of the goblins were found all over the place. Yes, it was now the talk of the town. Most of them think that it's the work of the monsters, and they also heard that Hud-sama of House Blelic headed out to subjugate it. Well, for the people, it was a relief to hear that the Holy Knights of House Blelic were on this case. But for Fate, those people were nothing but bothersome. They were definitely up to something mysterious, and now Fate could finally get to the bottom of it. He also hears the story of how someone threw both ears of a goblin king into an orphanage in the slums. This was a donation made by a great man, as the goblin king's ears got to be worth something like 10 gold coins. The kids got to eat their fill of some delicious food, and the orphanage committee is searching for the guy who made this donation like crazy. The people hope that they find this kind man. The scenes of the night hunt seem to be creepy as well as exciting. After some good sessions, Greed was certain that Fate was now getting used to balancing his servant work and hunting monsters. Well, more than getting used to it, Fate just really didn't want to end up falling into starvation again. In addition to this, he also wanted to find out what Raphael and the others were up to. Fate was sure that they were up to something sinister, but he has no clue. Greed tells Fate that those people may be evil, but they were not stupid enough to leave any clear evidence behind. Well, in that case, he'll have to lure them out. That's when a few people appeared, and now this is perfect. These three guys were rookies who came to hunt hobgoblins. One of them looked scared, but he was actually worried about that wandering monster. They decide to be careful and quietly attack the hobgoblins. But before they could attack the hobgoblins, the wandering monster showed up and took away their prey. They successfully spot the monster, and yes, it's a lich. Fate's plan was executed well, and with a black hood, tattered clothes, and that skull mask, he indeed looked like a lich. Fate knew that if he kept on revealing himself like this, they'd eventually come for him. Meanwhile, Greed notices something is coming at an incredible speed towards them, and he informs Fate about it. Damn, it was the Goblin Queen, and something was definitely wrong with her. The Goblin Queen was here to take revenge on her husband. She mercilessly attacks Fate, but he dodges it perfectly. The Goblin Queen growled in anger, and Greed was sure that she'd gone mad. Now no one can predict its next moves, so Fate has to be careful. Fate seemed to be quite confident and struck his weapon at the Goblin Queen. He attacks her without thinking about what will happen next. Now that it was finally going to end, Fate apologizes and slits her in half. He asked her to pass on his regards to her husband. After gaining some stat points, Fate notices a few people running away. It seems that those warriors found him again and witnessed something dreadful. Fate was sure that if he caused this much ruckus, the Holy Knights would have no choice but to make a move. A few days later, Fate continues his double life, working as a servant for the Hart family during the day and hunting goblins at night. Here, the Holy Knights haven't done much yet, and to get some more information about Raphael, Fate decides to consult Roxy-sama. The very next moment, he spots a beautiful girl. Oh wait, that's Roxy-sama. Fate approaches her and asks her if something is wrong, as she looks different from usual. Roxy-sama was glad that at this moment she met Fate because she had a job for him. Yes, and it's a super secret, special job. Whoa, Roxy-sama has a secret job for Fate, and the atmosphere here is getting exciting. Fate has to accompany Roxy-sama to inspect people. Yes, it was a super secret inspection, and they will be investigating the people's livelihoods. As a holy knight, it was Roxy-sama's duty to understand the living conditions of the people in the city. She was one beautiful girl with wonderful ideas. But wait, the most exciting part is that Fate Graphite will be Roxy-sama's escort. Fate seems to hesitate, but Roxy drags him along with her and tells him to call her Rox for the day. It was now time for a blast. Oops, sorry, it was time for some serious inspection. Both of them soon reach the city, and Roxy seems to be way too excited. Fate was glad to see her smiling like this for the first time. Roxy usually acted tough to live up to her position as a holy knight, but who knows how much she craved to have fun like a normal girl. So Fate decides to escort her properly today. He approaches her and finds that she was glaring at the gemstones at a jeweler's stall. They were simply gorgeous, and for Roxy, they were quite a bargain as they were only a silver piece each. Seriously, that's literally a 2-year wage for Fate. His eyes then fall on the gem ores, and the shopkeeper asks him to try his luck and see if there are gemstones inside. It was only for 10 copper coins. It wasn't cheap, but it was worth a try, at least for this girl. Fate uses his appraisal skill and gifts her a gemstone. This was a present to thank Roxy for everything she has done for him. Fate asks the shopkeeper if he can get something to break open the gemstone, But Roxy doesn't need it as she's an awesome holy knight. They. It's a hit. Of course it is. Roxy holds the beautiful gemstone in her hand and glares at it. She thanks fate for it and promises to treasure it. Next up, during their investigation, they find a kid who apparently got separated from his mother. Well, this was troublesome, but they couldn't just leave him alone. Roxy approaches the kid and questions him about the incident. But the pressuring aura of a holy knight is too much for a kid. And so he starts crying. Okay, fate can handle this nicely. He tells the boy that they'll help him find his mother. The child seems to be fine now, and looking at fate's sincere smile, the kid smiled too. Fate holds the kid's hand, and they begin their mission. This was unfair, as even Roxy wanted to hold the kid's hand too. They search here and there for the kid's mother. They then feel hungry and happily have some food. It was almost time to get back, but they still couldn't find the kid's mother. Now that it was getting dark, they decided to continue tomorrow. Roxy tells the little boy to stay at her house tonight, but the kid is now extremely sad. He starts screaming for his mommy and cries bitterly. That's when a lady is seen coming running towards them. Yes, she is his mommy. The kid happily jumps and hugs his mother, and this is great. Both the mother and son thank fate and Roxy and return home happily. The kid had indeed become quite attached to them. Fate then notices the beauty of the sunset, and the alluring and dazzling beauty of Roxy Sama. This was an exquisite scenic view. Roxy catches Fate staring at her and asks if anything is wrong. Ahem, ahem, it's nothing. Well, now that everything was fine, they needed to get home soon, or the senior maid would scold them. They hurry and get back. And regarding the talk that they had regarding the territory, Roxy Sama has decided to take Fate along with her this weekend. They were going to go together, and Fate was more than happy to accompany her. While traveling to the territory, Roxy Sama asks Fate if he dislikes the idea of visiting her territory. He just didn't look happy, but this was all because he kept thinking about the Bleliks again. This was not good, as he should be enjoying Roxy Sama's trip home with her today. Fate clarifies with Roxy and assures her that he is really looking forward to this trip. They discuss about the harvest season and the grapes that Roxy gave him the other day. Roxy explains to him in detail about how this place wasn't originally suited for growing grapes and how it took years of dedication and work to improve the quality of the soil until it became rich. It was indeed the pride of the Hart family. But this also resulted in the appearance of monsters who were after their rich harvest. The kobolds were troublesome monsters that an average warrior wouldn't stand a chance against. They tend to move in flocks and work together in groups. They were also hard to ambush because of their good sense of smell. Hunting kobolds was part of the reason Roxy returned here at this time every year. They came from the canyon, and she was certain that they would come this year as well. Meanwhile, Fate's stomach growls, and damn, it's gluttony that is responding to the kobolds. Abruptly, their carriage halts, and it's the Arrowwolves that call this field their home. Roxy Sama asks Fate to stand back, and she easily fights them. Roxy was simply amazing, and it seems that the title of Holy Knight wasn't just for show. They finally reach home, and Roxy's mother welcomes them warmly. She quickly glances at the bot standing next to Roxy and asks her who he is. Roxy tells her mother that this is her newly hired servant, and Fate Graphite introduces himself formally. Aisha Hart greets him back enthusiastically, even after suffering from a terrible illness. Aisha then directly asks Fate whether he likes Roxy. The younger generation takes it the wrong way, but she was just asking what he thinks of her as an employer. Well, Fate tells Aisha that he adores Roxy Sama immensely, and he declares that if she would like to have him, he would be glad to support her for the rest of his life. Whoa, this brat is crazy. He very well knew that they could never be together, but he could be with her, at least as a servant. Well, Roxy Sama was blushing deeply, and she got shy and ran away to her room. Aisha then requests that Fate-san please take good care of Roxy. Yes, she could definitely count on him. It had become quite late when Fate finished some work where he helped in harvesting grapes. He was now in a hurry to get back to the house. That's when he spots a person coming towards him with a weapon. Moreover, this person has red eyes. He takes a look at her, and it seems to be the same as his red eyes when he is in starvation. He tries to use his appraisal skill on her, but he can't see anything. The girl with red eyes then approaches him. The girl with red eyes calls out to Fate and asks him if he is listening to her. Fate asks her what she wants, and she tells him that she doesn't want anything as it seems it's still too early. She tells him that she came here chasing kobolds, but now he can have them. Now, Fate owes her one. He tries his best to ask her what she was talking about, but this red-eyed girl ignores him and walks away. She assures him that they'll meet again soon. Fate was almost dying of curiosity, as he wanted to know who she was and wondered if they were the same. Suddenly, Fate hears Roxy Sama calling out for him. She has been looking for him everywhere, and she notices that Fate looks scared. He tells her that he's fine and that nothing has happened. Roxy then spots the same girl, and she knows that girl is a galleon. It was odd for a galleon to be roaming in a place like this. Oh, so she's a galleon. Fate has heard of them before, but he thought that they almost went extinct quite some time ago. Yes, he was right. They were the original inhabitants of the continent Gallia. Their main features included tan skin and snow-white hair. Roxy knew that there was even a great nation called Gallia long ago, but she wasn't sure about it. Anyway, it was her first time seeing someone who looked so much like a galleon. Both of them glared at the galleon girl for a while, as though they desired to know everything that happened in her life. Then Roxy asks Fate to get back, as he must be tired. They both get back home, and whoa, it's dinner time. There's a lavish dinner waiting on the dining table for them. It included meat and whatnot. Fate seemed to be excited and he decided to do a perfect job by serving food for Roxy Sama. Roxy settles down, and she then shows Fate his seat and asks him to be seated. Fate couldn't believe that he was getting to sit right next to Roxy Sama for dinner, though he had dreamed of it many times. When Fate looks hesitant, two of the servants give him a push and make him sit. Both of them seem to be shy. And then Roxy Sama broke the ice and asked Fate to be himself. Here, he need not worry about manners and can eat as much as he likes. Fate digs in and happily fills his tummy with the delicious food. Roxy Sama looks at him cutely, and they delightedly enjoy their dinner. Later on, Fate follows a servant, and she tells him that she's grateful because he came, as it has been a long time since she had seen Roxy Sama so happy and carefree. Fate knew that Roxy Sama's father died fighting in Gallia and that her mother has a terrible illness, so he decided to do anything he could to support Roxy Sama. At night, Fate comes out with Greed, and he tells him about the weird galleon girl that he met today. He also tells Greed that she has the same red eyes as his and that he couldn't see anything even with appraisal. Greed tells Fate that the girl probably has something special, and he will understand before long. That red eye girl had something similar, and Fate had no idea what it meant. Fate then spots two kobolds and checks them out with appraisal. Well, they have strength up and that's great. Greed asks Fate to take the initiative, and he would have even if Greed didn't say anything. Fate attacks the kobolds, and they can't get away. After hunting them down, Fate realizes that there were only two of them, and Greed tells him that they were probably on high alert considering what happened recently. Fate wonders if everything will be okay, and he hopes that nothing happens to Roxy Sama. So that is it for this video, guys, hope you enjoyed it. So if you like the video, then hit that like button and leave a comment for the next part. Most important, subscribe and press the bell icon for notification. I will meet you in the new video, till then, bye.